wonderful people. How nice to see all of you here. So just a little bit about me. Diane asked me to talk story about my experiences and my realities. And then, of course, my daughter, who's now 31, but who was so psychic as a child that I took my cue from her for the last 30 years. So by training, I'm a landscape architect. But before that, I had been the typical 50s, 60s child, step out from, not a hippie, but just step out of the standard. And I studied metaphysics for about 3 years solid, looking for what is, what is the meaning of life? That was just sort of my bent in life. Why am I here? What's going on? Why don't my parents love each other as much as each other that I think they ought to? And so that's how I got started for my own self and my own life. I never called myself psychic. I just studied things. I was trained on how to read the Akashic records, just like Edgar Cayce when I was in the metaphysics school for 3 years solid. I did learn how to talk with plants, and I've got one experience of that. Oh, wait a sec. I can push some of these buttons, Carl told me. Oh, the down, not the up. Thank you, Carl. So I just put that one in there because I love it. It doesn't have any meaning other than that. And that one I also love just because most of you don't need that particular one, but that's the subject. For so many years, most scientists tend to ignore the fact that their science is predicated upon the matrix of the universe, right? It used to be called life force. Subtle energy, zero-point field. Okay, so, well, that's me many generations ago. There, plant the seeds of growth. I was forgetting to turn the pictures. Oh, what's in that micro-rain? Just to give you a little background for me before I start on the more amazing psychic children that I've been doing a camp for kids for 15 years. And their parents. The micro-rain, I didn't know what it was when I was a kid. I would look outside and I'd go, is it raining or isn't it? And I'd put my hand outside the window. I guess it's not. No, it's not even misty or drizzling. I was in my 20s at the metaphysics school before I realized that my eyes see prana. I guess that's what the Hindus call it, right? But I never told anybody that because, well, I was just a weird kid to begin with, so why make any, I never asked a question. This is my daughter at 2.5 or 3. And that's one of the stories that, we had the family bed. And she would tap on my shoulder, 2.5. Mommy. I mean, it's 3 in the morning, right? Mommy. Birds fly in the air by flapping their wings. Planes fly in the air, but they don't move their wings. How is that possible? So I want to let you all know, the age of reason is not 7. It just isn't. Also at 2.5, she would tell me about all the little fairies out around the live oak trees when I was, as a landscape architect, working for the Navy base down in Georgia, King's Navy submarine base, but I was working on environmental restoration, thank you. I was not doing any bombs or anything. And we would drive home from work, for instance, and I was a single mom. And I'd be thinking to myself, oh my God, do I have enough in the house? Do I need to stop off before we get out to the where we lived out in the middle of nowhere on the river that goes out to streams? And she'd pipe up and said, well, I want hamburger tonight. Oh, really? Driving the car. So those kind of things gave me a little hint of things to come at the age of 2.5. But I really didn't believe it till later. I'm going down the wrong arrow again. Ah, this one's a really good story. This is how I realized by 3 years old that I wasn't going to indoctrinate her into any tradition, whether religious or consciousness or science at all, and find out what comes out of her own heart and mind. So I didn't read to her books. I never told her the word devil. But one day when she was 8, and it was a Saturday weekend, and she had a fever, and she was sleeping in bed, and I was in the living room sitting on the floor. I think I was even talking to somebody. She comes running in, and she's, "Mommy, Mommy, make those devils stop. Those little devils, those tiny little red devils with points on their tails." Jesus, you know. I never talked about any of that superstition. But my metaphysics training, I could sit there and say instantly, "No, I won't make them stop. But you can." And I pulled her into my lap, and I turned her around so her back was to me, so she was facing her fear, facing her devil. And I said, "You tell it to go away." Now, she can have a fever, and just like somebody else mentioned before, I didn't tell her what to interpret. I let her interpret for herself, right? But I sat there, and I just pointed out that, you know, she was within my bubble of energy as an adult, and she's only 8. I said, "Take my strength, look at them straight in the eyes, and say, 'Go, you do not have right to be in my presence anytime, anywhere, any when.'" And then I learned for many years after that to say my piece, then shut up, and just listen carefully, and wait. And wait. And then I could feel her body just calm down. "Oh, they're gone now." "Oh, but Mommy, I'm up on the ceiling and I can't get back in my body." "Oh, okay." Do you all know the word silver cord? Do you know that concept? Have you ever run across that concept, anybody? Okay, so it's fairly standard, but not to everybody. So the silver cord concept is the idea that we have an energetic field between our soul self, and our physical body that holds us connected together. And it's infinitely stretchable. Now, some people don't realize that, but some people do. In any case, so I suggested to her, "Oh, do you see that silver cord between you on the ceiling and down with you sitting in my lap?" And she piped up. She's been a tomboy since she was very young. Piped up and said, "Well, okay, but it's not silver. It's blue, but it's all dirty and mucky." So then I could go and say, "Ah, well, let's just clean it up then." She said, "How do I do that?" And I just dropped into my intuition. I said, "Just see it as clean. Just wipe it away to the clear blue that you know it should be." Apparently that worked. And so then I decided to go a little extension. Well, she's out there. I might as well give her an exercise in learning how to use your out-of-body experience. I said, "Oh, how about, since you're up there now that you know it's clean enough and you can come back anytime you want, how about you just go outside up above the roof and go over to the river?" There was a little stream, I mean, behind the house that she and her neighbor, her friends, played with a lot of times. And she did that. She said, "Oh, that's where the Frisbee went." She saw the Frisbee that the kids had been playing with the other day, and it was up on a part of the roof at just an angle that they couldn't see it from the ground, but she could see it up there. Well, anyway, so then she came back and got back in. That's that story. That's her with, you know, that concept, the African things, the village thing. It takes a village to raise anybody. Well, it took a village. Every single one of those women are fellow psychic experiencers who helped me raise my daughter. Two of them are gone now, two of them still existing. This is my daughter at age 10 visiting her French grandparents in outside of Tours. By this age, at 8 and 10, she was experiencing massive conversations with angelic help and guidance. And this is about the age when she was visited by an angelic being of the 13th dimension. Things just happen you never know when they're going to happen, spontaneously, right? There's a point to this parallel. I mean, NDEs, right, and spiritual experiences and creativity and intuition, they're all of a piece. We are all highly psychic. We just haven't been trained to recognize it. I'm not trying to build up my daughter. I'm trying to share with you just some examples of what a natively born, highly psychic, spiritually transformative experienced person is like. But it's my firm conviction after the last 30 years and 15 years of having families come from all over the country, and some of them Hong Kong and France and Italy, to come to our family summer camps to say, help, can you tell me how to raise this kid? It's come to my conclusion, I have come to the conclusion, that we are all highly psychic, and we get less and less so because our education does not train it to us. And we should be trained at 2 and 3 and 4 and 10. And if it were part of our public dialogue and public school education, that we wouldn't even been as much in the fear state of fear of death or dying that I've been to some of the wonderful lectures about, if it were part of our cultural heritage to begin with. In any case, when she was about 8 and a half, I went to a conference in New York, took her with me, and she stayed with an aunt for a couple days, and then I took her to the, not the Museum of Modern Art, what's the other one? No, not the Art Museum. Natural History, no, Modern Art. Yeah, MoMA. And so I wanted her to see the Egyptian room, but it was closed. I wanted her to see something else she wasn't interested in. But I had the most phenomenal experience of watching this child just go instantly into drop-down mode of walking through a room that had been entirely rebuilt structure from the Middle Ages of a courtyard. And as we walked through this huge opening, and there were people behind us. It was the end of the day, and we didn't have much time. And she stopped dead in her tracks, and people stopped up. She saw a golden pieta. Do you know the word pieta? Is that only a Catholic term? The Mother Mary holding the dying Jesus having been brought down off the cross. Now, remember, I didn't teach her anything because I wanted to find out what her native inner knowing was. She stopped dead in her track and she whispered, "Who is that?" It was so precious to her. She was in, I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden, and then she walked up to it with reverence, if you can say an 8-year-old tomboy walks up to anything with reverence. And then we turn around and there's a triptych in a glass case over that way. And she said, "Oh, but it's missing something. There should be something over there." She dropped into some kind of memory. And in any case, we walked through that room and into another room. And there were some Middle Ages pieces of what do you call it? Lamps, you know, lamps for gas, lamp, I mean, a light, candle things, that, and little brass with pretty little designs on, but the ones that she saw was plain. She said, "Oh, but that's missing something." And then we turned around and saw a different glass case over there with the more elegant design on the four sides. She said, "Yes, that." Just kind of just phenomenal, out of the blue, right? My daughter did this every single week for, you know, 15 years before she went off to college at 16. You never knew when, out of the blue, there she would be doing something like playing soccer, playing the violin, playing, you know, whatever, being a student, and all of a sudden drop into instantaneous in a different space and mode. And I learned how to just let it be, listen, shut up and learn. At 10 years, this is in France, so we also went to the Notre Dame. We visited with her father, who's French, and her grandparents are French. And she walked into there, and she walked up and stood dead straight at the altar, in front of it, some back from it, like a statue. She didn't move a muscle. I just went and sat down in one of the pews and just waited. And when she could speak again, I mean, I'm talking 5 minutes, that's a long time, 10 minutes, something like that. She said, there is a scroll inside this long marble altar, right? That you could go all the way around, it's huge. There's a scroll in there, and it's not quite in the physical. And it's golden, and it has writing on it. And this box can't be opened, but only by a Christed being. She's 10 years old. I don't even know that she knew the word Christ unless she learned it in public school somewhere. Have you ever heard a public school talk about the word Christ? So I just listened. And she said, what's interesting about this is that when it's opened by this Christed being, what's inside there has the power to power the entire planet. I have no idea, folks. I'm just sharing with you some of those seminal moments in one's life where you go, what else can you say, you know? And all right, so enough going on there. I'm using the right arrow. Occasionally. Well, my daughter's father, who we didn't live with, but he's a banker, and his bank kept taking him to different places. So my daughter got to be very lucky. You know, she lived with a single mom, but she got to go and visit wherever he was working, which meant, in this case, to Mumbai, and then and before that, Singapore, and then Cairo. So this is some point where they've gone off to Cambodia, and they just were practicing some of their spiritual traditions to understand other different ways of being. I just thought. The child on the right was one of the adult older women, and that lady, Bonnie Mott. She's got about four generations there. Oh, no, the one down on the bottom. About four or five generations there. That entire family has a psychic capacity, spiritually, a spiritual capacity back every single generation, something going on. And I don't know what to believe. I don't know what anybody in this room might have an idea of. Do you think psychic capacities are inheritable? Is it in the genes? Or is it in the soul that doesn't have anything to do with the DNA? I don't know, but I think it's an interesting question. Okay, I entitled this show, Are You Crazy? Partly because when my daughter was 14 and when she was 10 or 12, let me back up just a story to get to this point. It's kind of fun. So I'm driving my daughter to school, fifth grade, before we homeschooled for sixth grade. And she pipes up saying, you know, Mom, how come I wake up every single night and the phone clock. The clock says 4:44. Mom, how come I'm waking up every single time and it's always that exact time? Oh, Lael, well, you know perfectly well how to talk with your spirit guides. Why don't you ask who's waking you up then? Somebody's trying to say hi to you and has something to share. And she said, oh, okay. Remember, this is a major tomboy. Okay, I'll do that tonight. Well, here's the deal. Spirit has helped me raise this kid. And any time spirit, whatever spirit, we can't prove who, right? Whenever time a spirit knows that the mom knows something that the kid doesn't know, he pipes up and says, okay, well, let's go have this conversation because now we can have a conversation where there's some useful dialogue can go on, right? So here we are driving down the highway at 70 miles an hour, 65, and the kid says, oh, you know, I'm driving, I can't look at her, but, well, he says, yes, I've been waiting for you to notice. And my name's Hanghua, and I'm from the 13th dimension. And I'm waiting because I'm here because I want to get all the psychic children together so they can work, so they'll know each other as adults, so they can work together to help heal the planet. That's all you too, guys. You know that, right? So, because of that, he also said, it was a he, would you please write a book? Well, here I am, a single mom, working in landscape architecture. I got to get to work. I don't have time to write a book. And it's 1996 or so. And however, Spirit has always helped me help whatever, why my daughter's here, what this generation of kids are here for. And so all of a sudden a physicist shows up and says, Nancy, it's really important that I help you get your kid on the internet, which was very brand new, sort of, for at least for general. Well, let me show you how to use this internet. Well, let me build you a website. Thank you, Dan Winter, if anybody's heard of Dan Winter. So that started that. And because of the website just started there, for anybody who found it, we also, the media likes to grab hold of things that are new and different, right? I mean, I can't tell you how many journalists and video production companies that have called me up and said, well, we're doing this promo and we want to present it to A&E, and can we come film your camp? That this is jumping ahead of that. I basically have turned down everybody except BBC, except they didn't get the funding they needed. So the only company that had enough heart-centered integrity that would understand that the children are so, it's so close to their heart that they can't share it. You know, they didn't have the dollars for it. So, I just got called 3 days ago. Can you please, blah, blah, blah. I don't know when the time will ever feel right. But obviously it's right for grown-ups, and it's right for NDE people, and I wish they'd come and film you guys because so we can get it on the air. In any case, I did say yes. We did say yes. When did the Sixth Sense movie come out? Does anybody know the year of that? Oh no, got to be way later than that because she had to have been 12. She had been 12 or 13. Okay, so 97 or 98, something like that. So this one company out in California, and I live in North Carolina, said, "Could we interview your daughter?" Well, Spirit wants us to get the kids together, and this would be one way. And my daughter said, yes, Spirit says yes, this would be helpful. So we allowed them to do that. They wanted to do it for what's called Sweeps Week, right? And, the upshot was they did their Sweeps Week. They did their little segments every night for 2 minutes and two other mothers and children besides ourselves. And at the end of the week, of talking about, well, these kids say they're psychic, they do this and that. Then what does this California company do? Television station do? They bring in the debunker, right? But guess who the debunker was in 1997 or 98? It was a Yale psychiatrist. He must have been found. He must have been born in 1895. He looked that old. And he proceeded to tear me apart. He proceeded to say that my child was schizophrenic and that me and the other two mothers were obviously attention seekers and delusional and should be put in whatever. That's where "Are You Crazy?" comes from. No, you're not crazy. I've spent the last 15 years looking up the science to say, I can follow a pattern, I can build a new model, I don't need to go out and prove it to anybody, but I at least need to have an internally consistent model that could make sense instead of prove why my daughter is not psychotic, she's psychic. So that's how that comes about. None of you are crazy. You all know it, but proving it's another deal. So I can share some of what I've come up with as we proceed here. John Locke? John Locke, when we move our legs, arms, eyes, head, and so forth, it takes power to do so. Okay, did I put the right word up there? Life force. Everybody in the Western world used the word life force until 200 years ago. They understood that the soul was part of the life force. Okay, I don't know why, I mean, I think even Newton knew it. But how Newton got turned into being only a materialist, I don't know. I'm just going to run through this because it was actually originally built for a different lecture. But I thought you might like to know some of what I've been using as a scientific basis for saying my child's not psychotic, she's psychic. Okay, have you ever heard of this one? Claude Swanson? If anybody's interested, that's an extremely excellent. He was the editor of this book. He brought together the best science he knew how to bring together, and it's a fabulous read if you ever want that depth of reading at the scientific level. Well, that's my knee-jerk reaction going on there. We are being disempowered. We are being disempowered by omission. I grew up Catholic, so if anybody knows about sins of omission, that's where it comes from. You know, if you don't tell children that their fairies and their angels are real, and you kind of belittle them, you destroy our culture. We've been destroying our culture for God knows how long. It's time to stop, right? Okay, better stop that sentence before I get worse off. So, hey. If I had any kids in the audience tonight, and this is what I do with the parents and the kids in my classes and in my workshop on Saturday, I'll make you go through the same deal. Is that really a living body? Huh? Pardon me? It's a diagram of? Yeah, you think it's a diagram of a living body. If I were doing this in the classes that I take, what I usually have are 8 to 10-year-old boys. They adore it. And I put one on the ground, lying down, and I said, now pretend you're dead. And then one standing up. And of course the one on the ground is invariably wiggling. But that makes no difference. And then I ask everybody, what's the difference between the standing up boy and the dead boy? Anybody want to tell me? What is your vocabulary for that? Pardon? Yeah, well, I gave you that hint. Right. So soul, life force, prana, right? And how do you get that life force in the body is the trick. Okay. So this I lit upon this idea quite some years ago, over 10 years ago. So all the kids by third grade know the different layers of the auric field of the planet. We just seem to call it the atmosphere, right? It's just a word. That's out of sequence, but there you go. Supersenses. I've been using the word supersenses because, hey, that was a Newsweek. That was Charles Panatti was a Newsweek journalist, And he used the word super senses, and I thought that's pretty cool. And it's kids like it. You know, they like Harry Potter. And oh, does everybody know about Richard Gerber and vibrational medicine? He really is the one who created an absolutely wonderful description of how the science could work, and created a model. I didn't bring any of the pictures inside of that shows the causal fields and everything. Dr. Harry Oldfield, the life force of an orange, his work that was very helpful to my research for our kids that fascinated me is I was out visiting Singapore with Lael's father, and we all went to visit somebody else. We didn't see Harry, but he's a British. Do you all know about him? Huh? Oh, yes, no? Okay, one of the things that he did, he got an honorary degree in biology from the Queen or whatever. One of the things he did is he discovered how to take a photograph. Photograph is the wrong word, but imaging. How to image a human body and get it into the computer. And he calibrated it using 300, not one or two, 300 psychics. He said, I can get the frequency, but I can't get a color reading. So he worked just like Valerie Hunt, which is, I probably have her up there too. They both found different ways of doing, of building this information. She used one psychic, and she validated the acupuncture points by using points on the different chakra points, and that there's a impedance, is that the right word? An impedance difference between being on a chakra and being a centimeter and a half away from it. So we know that there's some validity there, right? And so anyway, what Harry Oldfield did was he calibrated his machine against all these psychics, aura reading psychics who could see, so that he could say, oh, let me back up. What was important to me in his research that helped me understand how to teach these kids, how can this kid be right and this kid be wrong? How can they both be right? Here's what's fascinating. What he discovered is that the shape of a person's aura, I mean, if you've got a little cloud of something going on here and a little something going on here, the shape will be the same between all the different psychics that helped him calibrate his research that gets into the computer, but not the color. Color apparently is far more individual to the individual doing the perceiving. And what he came up with is out of all those 300 psychics he developed, he said there's about 10 or 12 different palettes, he called it. You know, 10 psychics have a palette color range in there, and another 20 over here, and another 50 over there. That fascinates me. I don't know how to take that any further than that, but what it tells me is nobody's wrong. Everybody has a different way of perceiving it, and if we haven't figured it out yet, it just means we haven't figured it out yet. So that's one of my learning curves there. I loved his work. He's a professor. Dr. William Kalingo wrote this book. He's a professor of subtle energy and integrative medicine, it says there. What I liked about it, I think I've got it there. What I liked about this one is a whole page. I don't know if you can see it from here, but I could always email it to anybody who wants to know that. This is an entire page of, oh, gosh, I can read from here, right? You guys. Okay, of different words that all mean the same thing across every single culture we can want, right? The terms for subtle energy from the Dakota Indians is Ton, or Wonkan for the Lakota, or Ankh for ancient Egypt, or Ki or Japan, and on and on and on and on. In other words, there's nothing new about this life force thing. And we're now getting to the point where, of course, Einstein talked about immaterialism. I mean, basically his quantum mechanics. We're no longer in the material world, we're in the metaphysical world. Ingo Swann, does anybody know about Ingo Swann? Is that new to everybody? Oh my gosh, okay. Ingo Swann is a fabulous artist, but he was the father of remote viewing. And what have I got on there for you? Everybody know about the Stargate program of the CIA for the 60s or 70s. And 70s and 80s, when we realized, this is when the Russian, you know, the Cold War was still ongoing, and apparently we discovered that the Russians were way ahead of us in using psychics to remotely view what's going on halfway around the world in military bases. And he could do that. And he and some other people helped develop, they just took military officers and figured them out and all trained them. This is the point. We are all psychic, but it needs to be training. It needs to be trained. Okay, but then we can even get rid of the word psychic, because the end of the, I love that. He's letting me know. Mm-hmm. We can get rid of the word psychic. My daughter hates it. We've never used it. I just use it because it's a quick and dirty word to use for now, but please let me. I want you to know that I don't use it in regular conversations, but we really haven't found another word that is useful, that your tongue doesn't trip over on a constant basis. Well, actually, we have. It's called aware. back to Ingo Swann. For those of you who don't know him, one of the most dramatic ones is totally a military process, NASA process, for testing the remote viewing capacity, was that they had him in a locked room, in a room with, is that the name of it? A Faraday cage where you can't get any energy out of it. Thank you, sir. In any case, so that he could, they wanted him to find out what was this, one of the moon satellites of Jupiter like. He described it to a T, and we didn't have the Pioneer, I think it was, arrive there for another 10 days or 7 days or 6 weeks or something like that after he described it to a T. We know this capacity, and I love the phrase, what one person can do, anybody else can do. We just haven't been training it. We haven't been educating it in first grade or kindergarten or third grade. Can you imagine what we could all do if we were put through the same training as the CIA officers? Anyway. He was quite an artist. Oh, well, okay, I don't know how much of these we want. This was my, in one of my slides shows, this is what is taught for the senses, the normal senses. And that's what a kid in kindergarten is taught, and maybe in second and third grade too. But they never see anything else. They only talk about what you can see, right? I guess they don't know how to teach what you can't see. So this is, all right. Here we go. That's the match to one that I showed earlier about the layers of the planet's atmosphere, right? So I decided to develop, this is from the metaphysical layers. If any of you know the West, right? I mean the Eastern traditions that we have an auric field around our body that goes out, and it's usually drawn like this because we're drawing on two dimensional paper. But of course we live a three-dimensional life, or maybe a four or five, right? And so they're really interspersed. So I need a much better artist to make it an interspersed thing. But if any of you have heard of it before, you know, we're talking about the physical body closest to the body, then then the emotional body, the mental body, the solar or astral body, and then causal and cathartic and further out. And there are plenty of people who see these and or perceive them and understand that it exists. Jack Schwartz, for instance, no longer living, was a phenomenal businessman who also could see all of these things, or perceive is a very important word to learn, because we don't always see, but we perceive. And some of, like, I finally learned to not use the word hear with my daughter, who's basically an audience. She could hear anything she wanted, but she could see it too. Because I realized she finally said, when she was 14, by the way, she finally said, "You know, Mom, I don't just hear. In fact, I don't hear. It's this and this and that and that, and I put it all together, and then I tell it to you." So I kind of learned as we went. Oh, I threw that one in because that's from one of our camps from about 10 or 12 years ago, and this is how to make intention visible, how to make something that's not physical to show the power of the human mind. That's not a very good photograph of it. I was trying to get them to every day to only one of those tables to send love to the plants and to see if more flowers would come out on one plant on this table than on that plant. And it sort of worked. We needed more work on that. One of the other things we discovered in training all these kids, that child there speaking to us as 8 years old was talking high-level physics. So what we had to do was find a physicist in California where he lived at one of the local universities who was not averse to talking to an eight-year-old talking physics and was not averse to talking to an eight-year-old who was talking physics because he remembered it from another lifetime. Do you know how hard it is to find a physicist who'll do that for you? Okay. Oh, well. All right, that one on the right is a picture of my, there we go. The one on the left is my daughter when she's 8. She never told me she saw things, and even though I know she heard things, I didn't put two and two together. And then our karate group went to a body, mind, spirit lecture event in Atlanta, about 3 or 4 hours away from us, and there was one of those early oral reading things. This must be 1997 or 8, and no, earlier than that, 85, 92 or 3. And I said, "Here," she's running around with all the other kids. I said, "Here, sit down there, would you?" And I had the picture taken. And so she saw the picture and didn't say anything to me. She went back and played with her friends. Then we're driving home in the dark in the night, and she said, "You know, Mom, I can do that too." I have no idea what it's referring to because it's 4 hours later. I said, "What? You know, darling, what?" She said, "You know, see the way that photograph you made me take was." So that's lessons learned if you want to talk with your children or your friends or your grandparents. You know, if you don't ask, you may not get it. People spend a whole life not sharing. Ah, we got to switch this off, right? We got to start talking. And that one other was another friend of mine. We also have to have a little bit of trust and not assume that all our kids are making things up every time they draw something. That particular one was an alien who came to our living room. And she was by that time already 14 or 15 years old and very bright and, you know, self-educated and not much of a bright drawer, though. We'll not give her that, right? I just find it fascinating that she was able to do that. That was an interesting event, because she's had about 4 or 5 aliens come in the non-physical form, And they came as early as 5 years old for her, and they were in the form of Indians. And I just let her be who she was. And I didn't put any prejudice to anything. She would say that the Indians were playing with her. One day she told me, "Oh, please, go out and we've got to dance with them. They're here. Okay. She maybe put my hands out so we could dance in a circle with an Indian that I couldn't see. So I thought that was kind of fun, but I never thought more of it because she played with them all the time and she had such memory of being an Indian herself when she was a lot younger. In another lifetime. But so later on, it finally triggered on me. One day she was playing with the Indians again, and then she came in and she said, "Oh," I said, "How come you came in? I thought you were having so much fun." She said, "Well, they said they had to leave and go back to the ship." Ding, 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 ding. You know, the kid is old. Well, that was probably when she was 10, not 14. But, you know, they don't notice what they've said. I mean, because they don't mind the inconsistencies. But if an Indian is all of a sudden going back to ship, oh, my God, I wonder if it's an alien who has the capacity for immaterialism, invisibility. And she said, "Well, I did want to know that. She went back out in the backyard, hands on her hips, forever the tomboy, and said, "I'd like to speak to the head of your group." And she sat there and waited. I was inside the house, but I looked out the window. She came back and told me later, someone came and said, "I'm the one you asked for." And she said, "Are you really an alien and not an Indian?" And he said, and she said, "Well, I'd like to see what you really look like, if you don't mind." And he said, "Are you sure? Are you ready now?" This is what she told me all later, right? I didn't hear all this conversation. She said, "Yeah, I think so." And he proceeded to move out of Native American Indian look and garb and become a 10-foot-tall praying mantis. That was when she was 10. So that's 1995. It was another 10 years before I heard a lecture on YouTube, which I have never been able to re-find, from a retired military officer giving a TEDx lecture in Spain, in English, but in Spain. And he said, "Oh yes, we have praying mantis scientists working in Colorado and have been for 5 years." I'm just reporting what I've heard. I can't verify anything. Well, that's interesting. Huh. All right. This old model of the senses. I didn't know how that got out of line. The seventh sense. Okay, Lynn Buchanan was one of the military men trained with Ingo Swann for the CIA Stargate program. One of the fabulous things about this book that he said was what they discovered in those 20 years of research with the CIA discovered is that 90% of what our common culture has called psychic is actually extremely, extremely well-defined normal five senses. And that's really empowering to me. That means every single one of us sitting here has the capacity for what my daughter does within their own range of what their special interest is. And because of that, we started developing a questionnaire for our families that came to our camps of making statements from what does this kid experience? What does that kid experience? What does that kid experience? Well, have you experienced this? And I'll show you that. I don't know if I have that slides up. Because what we know other people can do, we can do also, right? The 4-minute mile. You know about the 4-minute mile concept? Whoever the runner was who broke the 4-minute mile running, then ever since then, every runner is able to break the 4-minute mile that didn't think they could. Lynn Buchanan gave a great story in this book. I absolutely adore it. He was talking about himself being in training for learning all of these different skill sets. And I don't know if it was a hospital setting or military, but a military base, and they were going down to the cafeteria for lunch, a break between lectures, just like here. And they were standing outside the big double doors, waiting their time to go into the line. And he got friends behind him and friends in front of him. And he got up to the door, and all of a sudden, he started going like this. He said, "Man, who left all these cobwebs in the door? Ah, gosh, get them out of there." And his friend started laughing at him. He said, "What's the matter with you?" He looked around and finally realized it was all the way across the room. It's a big cafeteria, right? All the way across the long room, all the way back to there. Somebody was in line, and they had picked up their styrofoam cup waiting to get in line to put whatever juice they wanted in it, and they had their thumb going like this on styrofoam. It had set up a static charge, and he had become so sensitive from the training, rigorous training, that he felt the static charge on his face from that distance. We all have the capacity. Giftedness or awareness is a choice, not a fixed quantity. One of the reasons my daughter absolutely hated the word psychic, other than the fact that the culture thinks of it as taboo and poo-poo and whatever, and makes you feel out of it. When I asked her one day when she was, 12, 13, and just before we started the camp, I said, "I know you can't stand that word, but what can we use instead? What is it you do that most of us don't do? What word can we use instead?" And she thought for a moment and thought for a moment. She said, "Well, Mom, I guess I'm just more aware than most people. But that doesn't make me better. That just means everybody has their choice of where they want to be aware. And, maybe I've lived more lives, or maybe I've done this or that, but it's like a 360. Anybody can do it if they want to. It's a choice. But the word psychic, for instance, says you are or you aren't. You're gifted or you're not. No, your awareness is a choice. We can feel into that dimension or not. All right, so much for that. Okay. Oh, Carl, I'm now running on reserve battery power. Is that okay? Just to let you know. Okay. All right, so what I've developed, my new model that I hope that I can take to the Department of Education and the UN and say, look, it's time for us to start teaching all these other senses that we all have that aren't getting trained in elementary school or middle school or high school. And I had to read college, graduate school textbooks to even find some of them. Do you know how much boring that is when it's not your subject and you're a landscape architect instead? Sorry. So what I just developed is a three-stage model. Here's the first five. We're never going to get away from five. The universe has got five embedded in, all the cultures have got five embedded in it. So, let's work with the first five, and let's work with the second five. And so one of the textbooks of sense and perception that I came across, there was this Michael, I don't remember his last name, said, "Well, we know there's more than just those five. There's memory and emotion and blah, 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 but that's not very well defined." I love that phrase, not well-defined. So he gave me an opening. Well, if they're not well-defined, then I can start building on it, right? So I started building on it. And there's time-space. And they know there's time-space senses. They just haven't put them into a model that has been taught yet. And recognizing, well, that's memory and cognition and identifying, feeling, and moving. And so here's the third one that took me a long time to work on that I would like to share with you all because I love it. I really think it helps. So if we've got seeing and you see space, you see time space, then what's the next thing over? Well, you could use clairvoyance, but that'll never get in the public schools, right? So the last set of lines, I said, well, let's find the English language words that have always been there. And I took my cue from Ingo Swann, who, by the way, was so brilliant that he read the entire Encyclopedia Britannica by the age of 7 in little old Telluride, Colorado. So in any case, what he did was he found the interpretation of words all the way back to using dictionaries that go back to the 1100s and the 1200s, which is when the English language really started formulating. So all of these words are as old as bejesus. Well, no, not quite, sorry. And they all mean clairvoyance, clairaudience, clairsentience, clairgustance, clairsentience. We don't need words that are inexact or from another language. We can use our own language and say what we mean. Anyway, I don't know if that grabs you or not. I thought it might be fun. How it relates to NDE experiences? I don't know if that sets any concepts and ideas in motion for you all. One of the ones there that I like the most is the one that took me the longest to figure out is appreciating. Oh, look at that. Thank you. That grabs you too? It took a long time. I wanted to use the word aesthetics, but guess what you have to do if you're trying to create a new model? You've got to find a word that can be both a verb and a noun. And aesthetics cannot be a verb. So appreciation is also heart center. We're talking about the heart. You know, we all live from the head, the heart, and the hara, not just the head. Anyway, okay, that's just more of understanding the linguistics. So I built a little picture that helps the kids understand that there's, you know, it's 5 times 5 times 5. I don't think you guys need that picture at the moment. I don't know. Let's see. The self-actualizing cosmos. Irvin Laszlo is a fantastic Italian. Well, he lives in Italy. I don't think he's from Italy. And he uses the word Akasha in this book and in another book. I'm kind of sorry, even though he's a fabulous scientist, I'm kind of sorry he decided to choose the word Akasha instead of ether, because ether is Greek, and most of our Western world comes from the Greek. And I think the ether, life force ether, is what scientists used to use until they got too scientific for their own good. Too materialistic. So in any case, for those Plato, I don't know if that. I don't want to lose you all here. I didn't mean to get into a thing without stories. If anybody else has questions they'd like to go to, but I did want you to know that I had to work off of the concept. I had to go back to Plato. I mean, I had to go back to ether to get us forward again. And of course, there's so many modern there's modern quantum physicists who recognize that the life force ether exists. And I think I got a slide in here on a lecture from a physicist who actually put it in great terms. Do you all know Malcolm Gladwell? Okay, isn't he cool? 10,000 hours. So if people say, oh, I'm not psychic and I can't be, oh, that would be too hard. Well, how many hours does it take to become an Olympic skier or an ice skater? It's a choice, right? Okay, there's my Nancy going off. Innate human powers. What can we do with our powers? So I guess you all, I'm sure you all know that your sensory perception is not the same thing as your spiritual experience. But our spiritual experiences ride on the undercurrent is how we perceive. You know, when people say, oh, we only have five senses. Oh, well, if you're meditating, you're not using your senses or you're not meditating. I mean, oh my God, give me a break. So what we have to do is understand sense in the word sense in a much larger term. So I gave you some of those words, discerning, communing, appreciating. Those are senses. They just happen to be immaterial senses. Instead of seeing this, I can feel it with what, you know? Or rather feel the audience. You know, it goes on and on. Okay. Ah, I threw that in. What do you all see in there? Do you see the kneeling person? I actually told you what it was. Do you see the kneeling person in there? It's not there for you? I happen to have been walking down the beach up in Wisconsin at our family's an island, a little spot on an island, and I had been told, I was just visiting, hadn't been there, that a student of Roberta Burley Marx from Argentina had been, Brazil, had been up visiting, and that there would be some little echo art on the beach. And I came up and I found it, and I walked ahead of myself, apparently, I didn't realize it, but I walked up with reverence to the campfire that was built out of stone. And I guess that was me kneeling at it. But I thought that was intriguing. All right, this is what took me the last few years to validate how are our children perceiving. And then the next question is, our culture is either dying or transforming. Either it's going to implode or it's going to transform, which means our education has got to either transform or get off, And so one of the things that came to me is, what can I do with working with the ancient spiritual science from the East? All of the chakras, all of the acupuncture points. And how can we build up people's self-empowerment, which is what Ingo Swann was doing, his two volumes on power. He said, why are we such a disempowered society? Because there's no power schools. He was just kind of straightforward about it. Well, there's no power schools, and it's not taught in school. If you empower everybody, oh my gosh, then the people at the top who've got the 1%, oh my God, they might have to give up some. Well, he didn't say that. I'm adding that ad lib. I don't know if you can see or read any of this, but this took me a long time. I researched for several years. I talked with my friends who were acupuncturists. I borrowed their books. I found out the Sanskrit terms and the Chinese, the Taoist terms for at least 36 points on the microcosmic orbit, if any of you know any of that part of the body, going straight down the line and saying, what are the words that are 3,000 and 4,000 years old that are describing each one of these points? And how can we put those words into common modern English that we're saying, how can we train this skill, this power? How can we empower this child? And say, there can't possibly only be two intelligences. You know, IQ tests are math and reasoning. Verbal and math. Is that the only way you can be bright? That doesn't make much sense. So then along comes Howard Gardner from Harvard Medical School and said, well, okay, if I look at the brain and maybe I can validate this. So that in 1983, he wrote a book called Frames of Mind. and identified seven powers instead of multiple intelligences is what he called them. Instead of the two, he added music and interpersonal. Do most of you all know this? I don't want to speak to the choir. No, you don't? Yes? No? Okay. So, intrapersonal, extra. I don't have all of them here, but so seven different ways of being bright. Well, apparently teachers thought that was wonderful because anything to help kids feel good about themselves instead of saying, well, I'm no good at math. Well, so does that make me a bad person? No. Well, maybe you're actually fantastic at dancing. You know, creativity, intuition. So he got us up to seven. And I think Thomas Armstrong and another educator got us up to eight. That's not enough. So I'm getting us up to 36. There's got to be another way. And you can, you know, it's not linear. It's not meant to be linear. But if you start with some of the work of Valerie Hunt that I mentioned before, and the frequencies, I actually recorded the frequencies from her book and interpolated in between. We are basically a living spiral of energy going up our whole body like this. And I'm working on that, and it should be out in my book by November. And in there, I've got the information on it, and I've got cards you can take home and remind yourself to come find my website. After all these years, 15 years worth of work, this is a highly important slide to add. Don't you love that one? Have any of you seen that on Facebook last year sometime? I mean, you know, spirit is everywhere. I mean, look at that. That animal even has its eyes closed. Is that not appreciation? Have any of you, I don't know if any of you are into Facebook and recognize how incredible the ability of the internet to bring us information far more than what we were able to do just 20 years ago. But there are more and more people around the world. There are countries that are declaring different animals sentient. We are in the midst of this massive change. It's wonderful. It's glorious. It makes my heart glad. Okay. Well, that should have been before the picture before. this one. It seems to be out of sequence, but I'll throw it in here. Eric Berglund is no longer with us. He was a Celtic harpist and went all over the world. He happened to have a friend in Nashville where I was living, and he was a healer, and he could talk with Gabriel, I think it was. So on top of being a Celtic harpist, he had a client base of intuition consulting or something. And one friend who was in our karate group, she had cerebral palsy and had been in a wheelchair most of her life. And one day, she decided she wasn't going to stay in a wheelchair. And her parents and her sister said that she was crazy, stay in that wheelchair. She said, No, I'm getting out of that wheelchair. And she came and she went to 5 or 10 karate experts and said, would you help me? And they all turned her down, except for the karate teacher that I happened to take my daughter to. And he helped her. And she walked with a limp in one leg, but she walked because he worked and worked and worked with her. In any case, she also talked with Eric Berglund, and he helped her overcome cerebral palsy and being in a wheelchair for 25 years before she said, this is enough of this. Okay, so in gratitude, he comes back. He usually has a client base. He usually had concerts in the, you know, hundreds or thousands, right? Or whatever, not thousands, but whatever, large, all over Europe and as well as the United States. He came to our little town, to our little house, not my house, but a friend's house, and we were all strewn across the floor. And he and my daughter, since I was an older mom, I was the only one who had a kid around at the age, so she went wherever I went, right? So she's listening to the Celtic harpist, and she whispered to me at one point, Mom, there's angels going two by two, two-inch angels going two by two, dancing down this harp. Psh, psh, It was so sweet. What was he playing at the time and singing at the time? He was singing Perhaps Love. Isn't that sweet? I love that. And she told me the name of them. She said they told her, this is important, I need to tell you this, because the story goes on. They were called Chi-Chis. Okay, so I wrote that in the book, put it down. I've been doing that for years. Until she was old enough to keep her own journal, I kept writing everything down. That's how you also become good at what you're doing, by the way, recording it with a date on it. Okay. We don't need that one tonight. That one is out of sequence for anything that, but it's there for fun. How do you become supersensory? By letting your kids be sensitive and make the biggest mess you've ever seen, right? Oh, I love this one. Leo was only 2.5 or 3, and Mom came to visit and took us to the coast. This is Florida. This is North Florida. I can't remember the town. And she was just loving the fact that the seagulls would come in and land. Total joy. And here's two pictures from... Here's a set of pictures from different years of camp. We've had families come from Hong Kong, France, Italy, Canada, wherever. So the upshot to the Chi-Chi's thing is 5 years later, or six, we finally started after she told the Chi-Chi's, we started that camp. And then one two-year-old child, and so Leo was 14 when we started the camp, one two-year-old child that was brought from Tulsa, the mom driving a baby across country because the baby was so psychic she needed help. She said, that two-year-old child, we found a place to go and have a camp out, and it used to be a boys' camp in the summertime up in the mountains. I mean, gigantic trees all around the place, and there were some leftover sweet little places to dance or have a campfire or something. And we walked up to it, and we kind of rededicated to it because it had been abandoned for a while. And we rededicated it, and I don't remember what we did, but said something spiritual, something nice. And then we were walking down the forest path, and one person stronger than heaven and me was carrying him because his mom had been sick, so she didn't go up with us. And he said, in a tiny little baby 2-year-old voice, "Oh, the Chi-Chis were here," when we were doing our dedication, rededicating that little circle space. I just blew me away. Okay, that's all I got to say. Do any of you have questions? Do you got any idea, anything you like to chat about or complain about? I like either one. I'll take complaints. No complaints? Do you have a question? Yay! I'm game for questions.
I was just wondering if you're aware of that the Waldorf school says you shouldn't overteach rational thought to too young a children. You should wait. Do you think that might be a good idea? Or are you familiar with the term Waldorf education?
Over vegetation or
Waldorf education, but it was developed by Rudolf Steiner.
Oh, I know all about Waldorf education. No, but I don't quite understand the question. Over rationalize over what?
He said children before they reach like 12 to 14 should not be over rationalized. They should learn to appreciate all the of nature and so on like that.
I agree with Waldorf. I also agree with Montessori. I also agree with taking the lead of a particular child in question, which is what I did with Lael. And if you've got a child reading at 2, don't tell them they can't read until 7. That's my personal mom opinion.
Okay. At some point in time, you said awareness is a choice.
Can you put it up your face?
Yes, you said awareness is a choice. Awareness is a choice?
Awareness is a choice.
Okay, well, there was a two-week period of time that I had profound sensory awareness.
Yes.
But I was just overloaded. Everything was coming at me from the plants, the animals, people, just overload. And yes. I don't remember turning it off, but it just went away. I still have some abilities, but not like I did the 2 weeks. So is there a way to manage that? Or
way to manage what? You don't want it? Or
no, I do. Well, I'd like to have it back. But
oh, you want
to,
it back.
Is there a way to manage sensory overload that is
spirit,
just like...
Spirits gives you a download and you want more.
No, I just want...
I'm sorry, but we've learned that spirit doesn't work that way. Spirit says, you got the message? Okay, I got to get on to somebody else now. Now go and run with that message.
Okay, but what my question was just being overloaded by everything coming in, and you said it's a choice. Did I turn it off? Do you think I turned that off myself?
Did you turn it off?
Yes. I mean, when you have plants talking to you, you have awareness of everything that's going on around you. I would go to the restroom, in a public restroom, and most of the time it was okay, but if somebody didn't flush the toilet, I look at urine and say, this person's got cancer. He's starting to have bladder cancer or something. I mean, everything was coming to me from so many different directions.
That's beautiful.
And it's just...
what I've recognized for me, too. I mean, I didn't share a whole lot of experiences of my own ongoing. I mean, I hear the earthquakes 3 days before they're coming. Oh. I forgot to tell you those kind of things.
Yeah, I'm an earth
sensitive. We could go on for hours on that if we had to.
I'm earth sensitive also. So.
Right. But...
that's a different story. But
what I've come to understand from that is that spirit also knows... Or your superconscious mind. We have to remember we can't prove whether we're talking to a different spirit or our own superconscious mind.
Okay.
Now, there's that. Mm-hmm. But when they know either we've got too much work, we've got too much stress in our life, or we've already been downloaded enough, now work on it, think about it, learn from it, mm-hmm. It goes away. You didn't force it away.
Okay.
You didn't do anything, but it'll come back. But if you really want it back at that level, if mm-hmm. you're prepared to change how much you have to change to do that.
Okay, yes, we're making some profound changes. As a matter of fact, I think material things are kind of clogging up the work. So my wife and I, we've actually come to a decision to get rid of about almost all of what we own and just really narrow down to a minimalist lifestyle to get more, yeah. So we're actually going to do some traveling because I'm an earth sensitive also. So we're going to be doing some traveling across the country and working with that energy. So I have signed up for your workshop too. So I hope to get some
good
insights.
Oh, good. Well, then there's lots more you get to learn then.
Yes,
I'll share with you all.
Looking forward to that.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
All right. Anybody else have got a question? All right. Thank you for nodding your head. Thank you for sharing.